Jessica, not content, after all in the shadows where he lurked, unseen by most, but not by me. If I could not ignore him, perhaps I could know him, make a friend of this friendless stranger. The friendless are eager to be friended. So now I have this nameless friend, a friend for life, he likes to say. He drapes himself about me and listens with both ears, so patiently, so patient. But my new friend is jealous, as new friends sometimes are. I must turn old friends away, even show my love the door. My friend has made it clear there's room for only one, including me. Now that no one's left from the life I've left behind, my friend declares it's time for dreaming. My friend is wise. By closing them, my eyes are open. The morning light springs hope eternal, but horizon light is setting sun. My tunnel's end has come. Hope falls eternal. If I knew his name was death, I did not know I knew it. And it can't be said I did not choose to not show, know what I should have. That the friendless are friendless for cause, and the bliss of ignorance is no bliss at all. Drifter got a very good round of applause while I stupidly waited for him to mention that I'd written it. Instead, he basked in the reaction, quite pleased that everyone assumed that the poem was his. I knew I could have yelled out that I wanted to read something, but I also knew the poem style would be so similar that it would effectively blow Drifter's cover, and worse, they'd think I'd taken it from him. It seemed far more politic to just keep my mouth shut. After all, I knew whom all that applause had really been for. When it was Rebel's turn, he offered a joke, but prefaced it with a little shout out. Hey, Drifter, tell this one to your Sally. He'll appreciate it. Uh-oh. What's the definition of a best friend? What dog? Drifter yelled at us. Best friend is someone who gets two blowjobs from his girlfriend just so we can bring the second one back to you. Everyone roared, of course. I would have laughed hard too if he hadn't basically called me a faggot in front of the whole wing. I didn't sleep very well that night, but after breakfast I was clear on what to do. We were still on a modified lockdown, so we were escorted in pairs to the showers. When Drifter was taking his, I leaned over to the guard. Listen, Miss Dade, I'm in a bind. Drifter's pretty much an Aryan. I thought you said you were a gay Aryan. We never had one of those. Right, well, I apologize. I was talking kind of fast, but no, I'm just a regular gay. And every day I get my HIV meds and Drifter is starting to get suspicious. I didn't know if he really was, but it sounded like hard evidence. The sergeant hesitated. I looked at him with pleading eyes. I was only supposed to be here one night. It's been a week. The sergeant checked his clipboard. Name and number? Overcrowding, sure. Doesn't make your job easier, does it? No, it sure doesn't. Thank God. I had him on my side. He grabbed another clipboard and scanned it slowly. Then he looked up at Miss Dade. Bunk opened up in Birch. Why don't you take him now? He scribbled my new bunk address on a piece of paper and handed it to me. Thank you, officer. In my entire life, I have never meant those words so sincerely. On the way back, Miss Dade added some crucial information. Don't tell Drifter where you're moving, okay? Why, what's wrong with Birch? It's a protective custody dorm. Yeah, I guess it wasn't considered good form for your cellie to find us, Drifter. I'll be back to get you soon, she said, locking the cell door. But we're not going anywhere if you don't have all that stuff washed off the walls. Drifter stared out with the look of a shelter dog who's been told he had to clean up his own poop to be adopted. I almost felt sorry for it. When Miss Dade and I got out of the building, she couldn't help but notice my smile.